David works with the organization that we've been bringing in speakers from the last 4 years now, and he also has some other endeavors that he's a part of too. I won't take too much of his time, but just invite you to come on down, have some fun with our people, and just share. That's all I have to say for right now.
Well, yes, so my name is David. My first name actually is Gordon, but Gordy the Pig forever ruined that name in childhood, and so I have never gone by Gordon. My father's name is Gordon, and so I go by my middle name. And just so that I warp my children as badly as myself, we make them go by their middle names as well. And so first day of school is always a little shocking as, what's your name? Oh, no, yeah, and so that happens. So I want to start off by just telling you a little about who I am and what brought me to this place. First of all, let's see if this works. That doesn't sound good. Okay, this is a picture of my family. Speaking of monsters, I have three. So my firstborn is Josiah, he is 11, and then I have Andrew, who has just turned 9. And then we had something called a trailer baby who followed along behind by surprise. And his name is Tobias, Samuel Tobias. And there is a long story behind that I'd love to share sometime, just about how God was gracious to us. We wanted a baby for so long. And we had finally given up. And then all of a sudden, my wife called out of the blue. I heard the word. I cannot tell you how powerful that was. And so Samuel means ask of God, and God is gracious, means Toby. And so we also call him Mr. Toads for short. My wife, the woman beside me is my wife, Rachel, who's also a gifted speaker and has worked on church staff alongside of me for many years. I was a pastor for, going on about 15 years, I was a pastor in various avenues of pastoral work. I started in junior high ministry at a large church on the south side. And then I moved from junior high up to senior high. I was senior high director for a while, and then they put junior high underneath of me, so I saw both junior high and senior high. At that time, there was nothing going on in our church for those who were post-high school. Literally nothing. We had an age gap from about 18 to 32, and it was just so amazingly noticeable, and so we had, as a church, spent millions, and I mean millions of dollars, trying to solve this problem. We started an evening church, we started everything imaginable, and could not bridge the gap. Well, that failed, and so then my students who I had in high school were growing up and had nowhere to go, and I said, we need to give this another try. We need to do something. And so I launched and I became overseeing college ministry I built, and then we had a young adults ministry that we built as well through Young Marriage. And my senior pastor, as I left, he did say, you have changed the demographic of our church through the work you've done, and we're very thankful. And so I have worked with a variety of age groups, starting young all the way through post-college. And during my time of working with young adults, you'll hear a lot about delayed development of our youth and what's happening, why are they leaving church. And I was passionate about that because these weren't just numbers to me. These were my students, and they had faces to them. Students that I had done classes with, mission trips with, and retreats with. And all of a sudden, they're not attending church anywhere. They're not going anywhere. They have left the church. And it bothered me. And so I decided to go back to school to focus primarily on what is happening during the emerging adult years between the ages of 18 to 28, what's happening to their faith, why are they changing, what's going on in the rest of their life. And so I started to do a lot of intense study. And through that study, I launched a nonprofit, which there's chapstick in the middle of your table. That's courtesy of a nonprofit. Please take it and use it. There's no strings attached. It is good chapstick, even though the cover looks like poop brown, all right? It is not poop flavored. It is actually good. But yeah, it's just something to tell you about our ministry. But EA Resources stands for Emerging Adult Resources. Many churches are struggling with what to do beyond high school. They don't know what to do to solve the problem and bridge that gap. And so what I want to do is gather various voices together to help the church. understand emerging adulthood and how their particular community can reach those who are around. And so that's what I started doing. But another desire of my heart is to help the parents of emerging adults. Because when your adult child leaves the faith, that is an extremely painful process. Come right in. You're not going to bother me. Come on in. And what happens when they leave the faith is you feel like a failure. And you're embarrassed to come to church. And you don't want to tell your church friends because, A, they're an adult, they've arrived, and they're never coming back or whatever garbage. And then on top of it, if they do happen to come back to church, are you going to tell all your friends about their life? No. And so they feel completely isolated and hurting. And you can't go to the internet because no one's writing on this topic. No one tells you how to parent an emerging adult with an eating disorder. No one tells you because it's much different than having a teenager. And so all of those things have inspired me to write and collect resources for the parents of 20-somethings. And so that's what I do for EA Resources. It was through that connection I became friends with Tyron McLuhan, and Tyron's like, we need to have you a part of youth leadership. You will find out tonight that I have a very unique perspective on emerging adults. I love them. I think they're fascinating. I think the church is not in danger with emerging adults and millennials. I love them. And so so when I write about it, I really have a positive spin on what's ahead. I run a second website, if you're interested, called More Than a Beard. This is where I just write and blog about various aspects. But if we talk about what adulthood is to millennials and to our youth within the church, we need to give them pictures of that. And so that's why I write for a website called More Than a Beard. However, this is a nonprofit, and so there is absolutely no profit in it. And so, since I left my church job that was paying my bills, I had to find another job. And that is where I was extremely blessed to start working at a school, transitional school, for 18 through 21 year olds with special needs. And so my days, including today, worked with escorting a young man by the name of Eric, who does not like me, who acts as if I am not there, and hits me on a regular basis. But I escort him to get him through his school day and to help him succeed at the school location. He was really having outbreaks at all times, and so I walk with Eric throughout the day, and I love on all the students who are there. And so this is one of my students, but I have this note, and I love to show it to my student, to the people I speak to. I got this from a different student named Mike, and he says this: David, you are a riot, funny, a little silly, and last but not least, you're my fourth best friend ever. This is what I get to do all day. And it is awesome. It is amazing. I mean, I went from working in front of and speaking to thousands of people on a church service to I sit in a classroom of 10 people. You talk about a change and a shift. But God has been doing so much in my life and changing me and molding me, and I couldn't go back. I could not go back. And so that's my day job, but I'm passionate about a lot of things. And actually, when you gave me the topic, I was like, whoa, this is awesome. I love this topic. So for those of you who are on the Christian Education Board, great topic as we talk about evangelism and how it has changed. This is something that is right up my alley as we talk about emerging adults and how they're changing the church and how they think differently. But I only have 1 hour to do it, so I hope to go through it and to get through. It's the first time I've ever done this, so in this setting with this topic, so I hope that time-wise I can get it done. If not, I'll just start cutting away and hopefully something will wiggle and be alive. All right? So, did I get through all that? Yes. In 1998, I was a junior at Cedarville College in Ohio, which is a very conservative Christian school there. And every Friday night, we used to do something called a soul winning. And we would go down to the downtown Cincinnati, and we would there on the interior downtown streets, we would just go up, walk up to people, we would hand them a tract called the Four Spiritual Laws, and then we would try to win them to Christ. And so we would go through the points, and this is what this means. Well, one particular night when I was doing this, I met a woman by the name of Ellen, who really, I think, changed my perspective on evangelism. And I received a letter from Ellen in the mail and after the first time of us meeting, and this is what she wrote. She wrote, "Dear David, I really appreciate your taking time out of your life for me. However, as I have said before, some things are definitely not worth it. As much as I would like to believe there is a chance for me to make up my mistakes, I have a hard time believing it. I don't feel connected to anyone or anything, including God. I know that's not good, but I cannot seem to pull myself out of this hole. Hopefully, I will be able to change things soon. I know that I am the only one who can change my life. I am tired of being a disappointment to people and God. Maybe that's why I can't ask Him for help, because I know I will only disappoint Him over and over." Wow. You just hear that tone of voice and just her desperate desire for hope and for help. Hearing Ellen's story, just even as I read the letter, I still have the letter. It just makes me weep and cry. Because Ellen is not alone. And Ellen is very real. And she's someone who's broken, who's trying to do life all on her own power, trying to be good all on her own power, but is in desperate need of some truth. And so, as we start out this year, there are going to be Ellens that you come across in your ministry. People who need to hear the truth. And that's why evangelism is so important as we call people and give them the good news of what it means. Give them the news that they're not the only one, that God does know them, and God does have the power to change their life. Two disclaimers I want to give you tonight as we talk about this is that my spiritual gift is not evangelism. It's not. If you were to look at a spiritual gift inventory, my staff would probably not say that. Have I won people? Have people been, life been changed because of my work? Absolutely. But I don't think it's my spiritual gift. And if that's what you're here saying, well, I don't think that's my spiritual gift. That doesn't matter because God calls us all to be sharing the good news of the gospel with others, regardless of our spiritual gift. But I will tell you this, there are probably people in this room who probably see more people come to Christ than I have, just because that's the gift that God has fired up within you and has used you in a powerful way. And the second thing that I want to talk about as we share tonight is you may not agree with everything I share tonight. And I don't ask you to. I really don't. But what I do want to do is I want to challenge you to think and engage with today's culture and to think about what it means for the church and what it means for you, because the students that are coming in your door this year are going to be different than last year's students and different than the year before, because our world is changing. And so as I share, think about that. And ask yourself, wow, what do we need to change? How do I need to change? How do I respond to what's going on in our world? Let me pray for our time, and then we'll go. God, what unites us here is a strong love for you, a passion for the gospel, and for the power that Jesus has to change lives. God, you have the power to change Ellen's life. And Lord, Ellen is real, and even today, God, she is. I pray that you will work in her heart and life and continue to give her hope. And I pray that in this room, your spirit would come and challenge us each and open our eyes to your truth and to change us, I pray. Amen. Well, if you look at this title and you're going, oh my goodness, I am completely overwhelmed already by this title, don't be, because what we're going to do is we're just going to dissect this piece by piece. Sorry, I'm right in your way. So I don't know if you want to move for free. You bring my notes? Yeah. Oh, that's right. Oh, yeah, in the middle of your table are my notes. So grab them, please, and just doodle on them. If you're bored, I will not be offended, all right? Doodling makes most people very aware and more attentive. So I understand that. So if you're a doodler, a writer, or whatever, if you throw a paper airplane at me, I might be a little offended, all right? But other than that, yeah. So my notes are in front, so you have that right there in front of you. There might be a little more on it, but not too much. So I just want to start off by just looking at what this all says. Sharing the gospel in a post-Christian postmodern society. First word I want to look up is era. When we talk about the word era, era is a period of change within the history of the Earth. So if we look at the physical Earth and the changes that have happened, the scientists would label it as the Precambrian, the Paleozoic, the Mesozoic, and the Cenozoic. I'm not a scientist, I don't understand a lot of that, but what it mostly means is that they put it in long periods of thousands of years, and all of a sudden there's a major shift and change, and this happens, and now we have a new era. And so that's what era means. And in order to have an era change, that means we have to have change. And when we talk about the church and change, typically the church doesn't like change. None of us really, I don't know, there are a few people who thrive on change. Can we see your hands? How many of you thrive on change and you're proud of it? Come on, there's a few of you, there are. And everybody's looking around going, yep, yep, we know you do, all right? But overall, there are some changers who thrive on change, but most of us don't. We kind of withdraw. We're nervous, we hesitate, we sit back. But when we think about the history of the church, it has gone through a lot of change. A lot of change, if we're willing to admit. Can I list just a few? First major change happens in the New Testament. The Gentiles are allowed to enter the church. That was a big change. So big they called a church conference, even in the book of Acts. That was a major change that had happened through history. Another change that happened in 313 AD, when Christianity was declared the official religion of the Roman Empire. It's a big change. Lots of changes happened as a result of that. And I'm not saying you're going to think all of these are good and all. I'm just saying the church has hit some change in some periods. Then in 1054, you had something called the Great Schism. Until this time, Christianity had really been centered in that area and it had been unified. All of a sudden, the Great Schism happens, and the Orthodox churches break off from the churches in the West. And it was over some theological differences. It was a lot over power. A lot of time, breaks in the church are due to power. But the break between the West and the Eastern churches still affects us today with Orthodox, Russian Orthodoxy, Greek Orthodoxy churches of the East, and then the churches of the West with the Catholic Church. Then something happened that, of course, we will celebrate within the Lutheran heritage, right? Okay, big change happens in 1517 with the Reformation, and Martin Luther goes and he ignites huge change within the church. I mean, you go from merely Catholic, and the Reformation starts within the Catholic Church, and then it's not welcomed, and then it breaks off, and then we have Protestantism. That's a huge change within our culture, within the church's history. All these changes happen, many of them triggered by power movements outside of the church and various things that were going on. Change happens within our culture. And can I tell you, change is happening within the church today. I believe in a powerful way. I think we are on the cusp of it being just as dynamic as when the Reformation happened. And obviously, I don't know, I'm kind of biased. I really believe in what's happening and changing within the church. And I think the church needs change. I think that it needs change desperately. There is a book that came out in 1998 called Who Moved the Cheese? And it's a parable, it's a story basically about how, and I could be butchering this, I read it years ago. Basically, the concept is you have a mouse that's trained to go to a certain area in a maze, and you do it day after day after day, he's going to go to the same cheese pile. But what happens when you move the cheese? What is the mouse going to do? Is it going to keep coming to the same spot day after day after day, and then not finding cheese, just going to shrivel up and die? Or is that mouse going to go, oh, there's no cheese. I need to change plans, and I'm going to go somewhere else and look. What I believe is happening with the church here in America is we have gotten used to a cheese being in a certain location. And someone has moved our cheese. And now we are wondering, what are we going to do? How are we going to change? What are some of those changes? Well, in our title, first change is we are now living in a postmodern era. Postmodern era. So when we talk about systems of thought and eras of time that have changed, if we break it up into major sections, the first one will probably be the Middle Ages, which is often called the Dark Ages, where really intellectual thought was limited to within the walls of the church in many ways. And so during the Middle Ages, changing out of that, the next era was modernism, and then the following, what we're in now, would be considered postmodernism or postmodernity. Leading out of the Middle Ages, what really led us out, there are several factors, but let me just mention, I have four. One of the major factors was the concept of exploration that was going on, is that we were exploring more and more parts of the world, and cultures were becoming more united. And so we were going off, the world of exploration was happening, they were discovering the West and various other places. A second thing that happened was the Renaissance, which is called the rebirth. It's sometimes also called the bridge to modernity. Some great thinkers during the Renaissance, such as Immanuel Kant, Descartes, and Locke came out, and they just started thinking in new ways. But the unique thing about these teachers that wasn't as true is that there was an invention that came along, and this is true of Martin Luther as well, that made him much, much more famous. And that invention was the printing press. And with the invention of the printing press, Martin Luther wasn't just affecting his church, he was affecting all churches. Because his manuscripts were being published and imprinted and handed out, and so it was a much, much wider scale. And so as we get to these great thinkers, their thoughts and ideas are being carried through the work of the invention of the printing press. And so this change is really what brought humanity out of the Middle Ages and the Dark Era into what they would call modernity. And we're going to get to concepts of modernity too. And I know I'm going super fast, but you've got 30 minutes of Q&A, right? So you can drill me at that time, all right? And you can go back, so write questions, mark it on your notes. Leading from modernity into postmodernity, also, let me mention three main factors that's led to this new change. The first one is not exploration, but it's a word that you hear over and over again, globalization. Because no longer are we simply just exploring the globe, but we are connected with the rest of the globe. Our religions are connecting. Our economic systems are connecting. There's so much that is being connected as our cultures and as the span between our worlds shrink in size. Do you remember the concept when a missionary used to go overseas to Africa? They used to never be able to come home. They used to never be able to hardly talk to their parents. That world seemed so amazingly far away. But yet, in today's world, our mind, because of the communication that's available, because of the internet, the world seems so much smaller. And that is an effect of globalization. And it's had an effect on our thinking and has ushered in many people believe postmodernity. A couple of the great thinkers that have really pushed this new thinking was Nietzsche, who lived from 1844 to 1900. And he was the one who, he's famous for saying God is dead, but he promoted that the view of the world is based on our perception. And he was one of the earlier thinkings of this. Another one was Wittgenstein, and he was the one who talked about how our language, the role of language in our community, greatly influences our view of truth. Now, don't worry about getting all who they are and what they believe. Honestly, I am not an expert when it comes to philosophy in many ways, but when I say these names, I just feel smarter, all right? So, that's why I throw them out there. No, not really, but yeah. But some of these philosophies that these men are teaching now come across. And then we hit this new invention that really catapults us into postmodernity, which is the computer. And so with the invention of the computer and the internet, which is, I think, ironically, I want to say 1994, maybe 89, some, I think within the academic circles it started in 89, and then it just started broadcasting bigger and bigger. And so during this time, you have the globalization of ideas all coming together through the internet. And so it brings our world in many ways closer, and we also changes us into post-modernity. I still remember hearing the word for the very first time. I was a junior in college as well, sitting in a chapel service, and a chapel speaker at the student government body chaplain got up, and he spoke on post-modernity, and I was like, whoa, what is this? And I really became, at that time, now the word had been used a long, long time ago, and it rose during the early 2000s and late 90s, and if you notice, it's almost tailed off. You don't hear a lot about it anymore, but the fact is we're almost immersed in it, and that's why people don't even talk about it. It is really an accepted philosophy of what has happened, except within the church, and sometimes, yeah, I don't know if I'll get to this or not, we have made it the enemy of the church, which is not a healthy perspective by any means. But I believe that is this issue of post-modernity that has really has affected the church today and what we're seeing take place. What we're seeing take place in the fact that our young people leaving the church with the decline in church numbers, I think really has a foundation in the differences between those who are really in their thinking more modernist versus those who are postmodern. Because in the church today, we have various generations, and many of them grew up during modernism and still hold to modernism very tightly. And then we have our young people who have known nothing but post-modernity. And when the two get in a room and talk about their faith, it can be like two people butting heads. And that's why, honestly, I think that now is the time as youth workers that often what you do is you mediate. You become a mediator between the generations and the different philosophies that are going on. And there is a desperate, desperate need for that as we try to help each side understand the other and the strengths and the weaknesses of each. But let's talk a little bit about what's going on here with postmodernity. This could be a 12-hour session, okay? So, and I'm giving it to you in 5 minutes. Can I just say, how many of you are familiar with terms postmodernity and those? Any of you? Okay? All right, so some of you have. But for some of you, it looks like this is really new to be talking about something like this. This is a philosophical change that's happening within our children. This is happening in your educational system. This is, even if you are in a conservative church, your kids have been raised conservatively, in a conservative rural community like we are here, your kids are, the educational system is raising your children to think in a postmodern mindset in the way that they think. Modernism has really been, is out. It's out of the curriculum in many ways. So what is it? Well, modernism in its way really valued science. It promoted science in every way. There was always a scientific answer for everything. Postmodernism doesn't limit the world to science, but really open the door for the supernatural. For instance, when you went away to college in the late 80s and 90s, and you were a Christian, you were petrified because you knew you would have to answer questions like angels. Angels aren't real. Miracles? Miracles are dumb. Why would you ever believe in a miracle? Those were the questions that our college Christians were really had to prepare to answer. Can I tell you, those are not the questions that Christians are getting bombarded by in college nowadays, because science no longer reigns. The supernatural is actually encouraged and accepted on most college campuses because of postmodernity. Science is no longer seen as the reason and the answer for all things, and they've opened the world for the supernatural, which in many ways can be a relief for college Christians and people who go to college from churches. All right? In modernism, they engineer systems. Everything, systems of thought, systems of history, everything becomes a system. Systems of business and how organization, whereas in postmodernity, If you mention a system, it's immediately suspect. Because systems are built by the powerful and placed upon the weak. And so when you, and as the powerful, you're only listening to your perspective. And so within postmodernity, they want to listen to all perspectives. And so when you talk about a system, you're immediately suspect. Modernism promotes, looks for the meta-narrative, the large story that makes everything connect perfectly. And so even with Christianity, you want the large story, which I'm not saying meta-narrative is bad, by the way, all right? But they want a large overarching story that connects everything. Within postmodernity, it's all about your story and the mini-narrative that's going on. And what is your story? Modernism will look at universal truth, that it's possible and that it's objective and it's foolproof. Within postmodernity, it looks for individual truth. And truth is subjective and it depends on your perspective. However, do not think that just because I don't want to jump ahead. All right, so keep going. Creating order is modernism. They want to create order. Everything needs to be seen in a certain way. Within postmodernity, it acknowledges the chaos. No matter how cool you make your system look, there's going to be an exception. So let's look for the exception, let's acknowledge the exception, and let's be okay with that exception, the chaos. If you look at, I don't know if all these are listed on your chart. I don't have time to go through all. How this is portrayed often in our theater, look at the movie Crash. If you've seen the movie Crash, won multiple bazillion rewards, mostly because of its multi-perspective of what's going on. M. Night Shyamalan was really big in the 2000s, often because of his perspective, he was bringing postmodernism to theater. In the movie The Village, what happened is their whole life they had grown up thinking that there was a boogeyman out in the woods, and they couldn't leave. And so their truth was created by the elders of their community. One day, one of the young adults bolts from the community, gets out of the village, jumps over the wall, and then discovers modern day U.S. But they had been living like they were in the 1600s because the community had established truth and they had defined the truth. And so the point of the movie really is that your truth is defined by your community and you can break out. You see it in movies like The Matrix, which were huge during that time. Even within theater, The Wicked. Any of you read The Wicked? Alright? It's a postmodern spin on an old classic. How is that postmodern? It's postmodern because it takes the opposite perspective of the main character. And so now instead of this witch being good, the other witch is good. And so a lot is going on where postmodernity looks at those things. It's portrayed in music like David Bowie. DC Talk in 1998 came out with a great song called Supernatural. Any DC Talk fans out there? All right. They were awesome in their day. But they had a song called Supernatural. And I just thought, what is the point of this song? The point of the song is Supernatural is real. And it's allowed in today's world, and they were celebrating that. Joan Osborne had a song, What If God Were One of Us, that came out during that time. A great Christian singer who really comes from a postmodern perspective is Nicole Nordeman. She talks about that. She still plays on the radio a lot today. You'll hear a lot of her stuff, but has some great insight. But this change between modernity and postmodernity is huge. And what I try to tell people, and I write a lot about, is that Christianity is neither modern nor postmodern. It's neither modern nor postmodern. And yet, we try sometimes to force it into one of the bubbles. Christianity did not fit well into modernism. Because science couldn't explain it. Science destroyed the supernatural. Christianity doesn't fit well within postmodernity. Why? Well, because there is truth. We believe that truth is there. And so there are problems with each world philosophy as we deal with our faith. So we are, first, we are Christians, and we're called to live in a culture that we're in. And today's culture is postmodernism. And how do we live? How do we function? And how do we bring the truth of the scripture to life in with the world that's going around us? So as we look at evangelism, and this is the world we're dealing with, how does that affect our evangelism? I mentioned the booklet, Four Spiritual Laws, and is a track I often used in college. One of the unique things is this was written for a modernistic world. The first couple sentences of that track actually says, just like there are scientific laws that rule everything within our world, so there are four spiritual laws. Do you grasp that? What were they emphasizing? They were emphasizing science. In today's world, that has totally changed. So if you were to hand the four spiritual laws to someone who is that, you know, young and postmodern, they're going to read that and they're going, whoa, whoa, whoa. All of a sudden, you're suspect. And what you're handing me is suspect because you're saying this is scientific laws and then they never break. But you know what? I know a lot of laws that actually there's a lot of chaos to. And so we have to be careful about that. Another thing about a lot of these tools, which by the way, I use these tools, so hang on. But we have to be aware of, though, is a step to peace with God, is it really does teach a meta-narrative style. It tries to focus everything in and make sense of everything in our world under one umbrella story. And so when you try to do that, you immediately become suspect to those who are in our world today. Then the third thing that a lot of these tracts do is it presents faith in the straight and narrow line, in the sense that, well, what I do is I first believe this, then I take a step here, and it gives a linear motion to our faith. And I'm going to grow here, and when I do this, I'm going to grow here, and I just go up and up and up in my growth as a spiritual Christian. Let me ask you this. I don't know about you, but my spiritual growth hasn't been anything but linear. It has been messed up at times. It has been hard at times. I go up. I go down. I spin around in circles sometimes, and I can beat my head against the wall, and I experience great victory. And there's so much about our life that isn't linear. And when we present linear things so clearly to people, they can be turned away from it. And so we have to be careful about that. It goes back to modernism. We have engineered a system. We have made Christianity a system. And this is what you need to do to abide by it. And all systems become suspect within postmodernity. So we live in a world that is postmodern. But another thing that we're fighting against today is we live in a world that is post-Christian. Post-Christian society. I don't know if you've seen the recent statistics. By the way, I am not a ho-hum, everything is down when I look at these, okay? And I hope none of you are. To me, when I see stuff like this, I am excited, I am energized by it. But these are the statistics right now of the U.S. religious landscape. This is statistics taken from 2007 to 2014. So, in 7 years, the last 7 years, evangelical Protestants have declined by 0.1%. Catholics from 23.9 to 20.8. Mainline Protestants from 18.1 to 14.7. Look at this. The religiously unaffiliated went from 16.8 to 22.8. This is in 7 years. That is a huge jump. This is making news. Because this is affecting the world. And I think most of us as Christians, we know it to be true. We see it. We see it going on. But what's even more shocking is, prepare yourself for this, is because of the age gap and how it's happening. So this takes those same numbers and looks at them by generations. So the silent generation, almost 30% claim to be evangelical Protestants. But as you move downward to baby boomers, Generation X, older millennials, and younger millennials, do you see how Christianity is clearly, clearly declining? and its role here in America. And we're still talking about millennials. Most of them grew up with a Judeo-Christian kind of ethos here in America. Not totally, but if they're just moving out of it. Just wait until the millennials start having children. Do you understand what this looks like ahead for the church? Change has got to come. Something's got to change. And a lot of times, churches have relied on people coming back to the church. Well, the kids of millennials aren't coming back to the church because they've been going to church. Well, maybe a few of them, 20% of them. But nothing like it had been. And so change is happening within our world. We are in a post-Christian society. And what does that mean? Well, it means that I went to a fall retreat once, and I had a student who, during a chapel message, said, I want to know more about the faith. So I sat down with him and started explaining the gospel to him. And I mentioned Adam and Eve. And he looked at me and he's like, who's that? I wanted to laugh. I thought he was kidding. I was so naive. There are going to be students that you are with that may not know those names. And even if they know those names, they're going to assume that they're myth or legend. And so what does that do for us in your group? Be aware of that. And so as we talk about a post-Christian society, what does that do with things like the wordless bracelet? I don't know, any of you ever used the tool, the wordless bracelet? It's a great tool, all right? It's got the colors that represent various things. So you have the black, the red, the white. I grew up on that. But I also grew up within the church. And so I had a Judeo-Christian understanding of the Bible and of God and all those things I had grown up. And so the wordless bracelet made great sense to me. But there's so much back work that has to be done in order to understand a concept like that. And those who walk into our ministry just simply do not have that backstory with them anymore. And we have to assume that they're coming in not knowing that because they've been raised in a post-Christian society. The fourth word I want to focus on is the gospel. And when I talk about the gospel, I'm not going to go through it and define it except for this, to say that it is good news. The gospel is good news. Amen? It has changed my life in so many ways. Romans 10, 9, and 10 is a simple passage that kind of just summarizes very briefly. The good news of the gospel is for all people at all times and in all situations. But the one thing I want to talk about, though, when we talk about the gospel is also not a magic spell. It's not like if you just get through the words of the gospel, all of a sudden the person's going to accept Christ or you've done your job. I remember when I was growing up in my home church, I went out, post-college maybe during this time, and I went out with someone, and I was supposed to be the protege, learning from this person about what it means to go door-to-door. We did door-to-door evangelism during that time. And we went up to this lady's house, and she had four kids at home. And they were it was just chaos everywhere. They were just yelling and screaming and curious and excited. You know, kids get excited when someone comes to the front door. And literally within 2 minutes, the man looks at her and says, are you happy we're here? And she clearly said, no, I am not happy. It was so amazingly awkward. I didn't know what to do. I was like the pupil, right? I was supposed to be learning from this guy. And so I was like, I want to show this woman love. I want to show this woman care. I don't know what to do. And so I just started talking to her kids, you know, and trying to relieve them of this really awkward situation. And this guy from Go did not take that as a no. And he went through bam, 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 bam. And I'm going to get to this person, this person, this person. And the woman is getting more and more angry the entire time. Not strong enough. I just didn't call the police, I guess. I mean, I don't know what she was supposed to do next. But we got in the car. He closed the door. He said, praise God, she heard the word. And I was like, what? She didn't hear anything. She is angry and ticked off at God in the church, and she is not wanting you there. It's not a magic spell. Like, you just say these words, and praise God, these words over that woman are somehow going to do something. No. That's a really unhealthy view of the gospel and what the gospel does. It's not a magic spell. What is really important is the manner in which we share the gospel. This is a 1 Peter 3:15 is a great passage, but I have a little different take on it due to our situation in our society. Okay, he's talking about, even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled, but sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts. Oh, okay, so apparently the people Peter's writing to are under some stress, some turmoil, some persecution, something's going on, but they're still remaining faithful. And so, sanctify Christ as your hearts, and always be ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that's in you. Yet, with gentleness and reverence. What has happened within the church and under modernism is they have taken that verse to mean that we have to have a scientific answer for every question that comes of us. And we have to defend, and the whole world of apologetics blew up. Alright? And so, and I'm not saying all apologetics is terrible, by the way, if you're familiar with that term, Josh McDowell. I'm not saying any of that's terrible. But what happened is they camped out on this verse and said, this is the center of converting people, is to give them the scientific answers they need to make their system complete. Well, that's because of modernity and how people viewed the faith then. And everything had to be a system and had to fit nicely into a box. Well, no longer is that true. And that's not what this verse says. It says, give a reason for the hope that's within you. I tell you, my hope and the reason for my hope goes way beyond my reason. And I hope yours does too. Because it's not because of a rational understanding of everything that's in Scripture. Because I can still, after 12 years of school at a seminary, I still don't rationally understand everything that's there. It's much deeper than that. But the power of your story is what you share. And that's one of the beautiful things about postmodernity is they want to hear your story. And it opens up so many avenues for us to share. And what do you share? You give the reason for why you hope in God. I think of the story of Job. In Job 2:9, his wife looks at him and says, in the midst of all his trouble, everything Job's been through, right? And he stood strong in his faith in God. She's looking at him. Are you still maintaining your faith, your integrity? Curse God and die. Job, just give it up. What reason in the world could you ever have for still clinging to God? At that moment, Job could have delivered one of the most powerful apologetics of all time. This is why I still love God. This is why I still choose God. And in today's world, regardless of what's happened to you and what some of your stories are amazingly powerful. Because, yes, maybe you've been hurt by the church. Maybe you've been abused by the church. Maybe everything has gone wrong in the pain you've suffered. And yet, you have a defense for the reason of the hope that's in you, that you have stuck with God. And that reason right there is going to be amazingly powerful in today's world. Way more powerful than you proving this or that or this. What's your story? There's a great tool that Youth for Christ has. It's called Three Story. And the Three Story has, it says, we need to listen to their story. We need to share our story. And we need to share God's story. And as the three of those connect, wow, powerful things can happen. So, we share our story, we listen to their story, and together we explore. Because I can tell you, even in my own life and in my own journey, there are times where I wish I just cursed God and died, just walked away. but when I get the chance to share the story of something that has moved me along and I've never been able to let go of my faith, that is something that people want to hear, and that's what they're looking for. So in today's world, I have technically 6 minutes to get to these. We'll see. There's four things that as we, now that I've overviewed kind of some of the changes that we're in, and I've given some practicals throughout of how this is changing our youth. Okay, but here are four things, and it's on, I think, on the back side. If I can point to four practicals, let me push these. First is authenticity trumps answers every time. Authenticity trumps answers every time. This is what is beautiful about postmodernism, is that you may be broken seeking to be fixed. You may be wounded seeking to be healed. And you may be lost seeking to be found. You do not have to be perfect to share your faith. You do not have to have all the answers as you step forward. When you have all the answers, then you become suspect. But when you lead with your authenticity, it opens up amazing doors. When you are broken, when you lead with your brokenness, when you lead with your woundedness. Let's see. And part of the reason, getting back to this earlier, is that is there more to our faith? Absolutely. Because what's more to our faith, and I just moved the slide, oh, it is in the right place, is that reason is not the basis. It cannot be the sole basis of our faith. Because we, without faith, we must have faith. You know, if our faith was all about reason and modernism and us figuring everything out, it would be impossible. Faith is clearly an aspect of our faith, of our lives, and our relationship with God. Second thing is that belonging precedes believing. Belonging precedes believing. In other words, in your community, do you allow them to feel belonging? Because often they want to feel a sense of belonging. I can belong here. And then that turns into them believing. What happens, though, in a lot of churches is we draw walls up, and you have to believe this, and you have to believe this in order to really feel a part of the community. And what they found out, and this phrase actually comes out of a study done by Campus Crusade, they're not called that anymore, Crew or whatever they're called, is that in the places where they were seeing evangelism the strongest were in places where the community accepted first, and then they just became a part of the community. And then after a matter of time, they saw these people's lives change, and they became to follow Christ. And so belonging is really important. So as a community, you have to ask yourself, in your youth group, is diversity accepted? Or do they have to agree with you in order to belong? Tough question as a youth worker, all right? Is diversity accepted? And I'm not pushing any political or even belief agenda when I say that, okay? But I'm just saying, in general, diversity is celebrated among postmodernity. And this is part of the reason, because they want different perspectives. They want all of that. And so do we make them change first, or do we allow them to belong? And I have down here a story of Eric. Eric came to me when I was working with our young adults, and I told him, after several weeks, he just needed a place to belong. He was very lonely. He was out of college, in the military, and he came to me, and he's like, is this a place I fit in? I don't know what I think about God. I don't want to think about this. And I said, absolutely, you can fit in here. We will care about you. You do not have to change your beliefs. You do not. We will care about you regardless. Eric started coming. It took about 6 months of him finding that that loving, cared for place. And then one day I received a text from Eric, and it was these three words: I accepted Christ. I kept that text for so amazingly long. It's probably one of the first text messages I ever got, because it was just so amazingly powerful. Because once he belonged, he knew what he needed to believe, because the truth was just part of the community. And so, belonging before precedes believing. Third thing is tone supersedes your tools. I talked about a lot of tools tonight. use them. Use whatever tools you need. That's fine. They all have ups, they all have downs. Whatever tool you need, I mean, some people used to use the Romans Road, some people still use the Romans Road. There are a lot of tools I've used through the years, okay? But what is most important is the tone. And if you talk about tone, a couple things I would push is humility versus your piety. Again, lead with your brokenness. Lead with how you're wounded. Lead with all of those things. Another thing is identify with them rather than just explain who they are and what they are, okay? In other words, try to be a fellow traveler. Identify with them as a fellow traveler rather than, well, this is what you need to do and this is how you need to do it because I was there and I did this. So you want to identify with them. The second thing is the whole, when you talk about tone and post-modernity versus modernism, words that are suspect, when you start saying, I know this, I know that, can you change your words? Because otherwise, when you start saying, I know, all right, that comes as very condescending in our world. It's a small change, but what I would say is just say, I believe. I believe. Now, does that mean, whoa, you're saying that there's no, I'm not arguing the whole truth thing. I believe that there is absolute truth in that kind of concept. But I'm saying for a postmodern world, when you start saying the words I know and you throw it out all the time, this we know, they're going, oh, red alert, red alert, red alert. Not buying it, not buying it. And so we need to be careful about that. Other phrases that we want to throw out, be careful about, is this passage proves, this passage instead, you want to look at this passage maybe teaches, or you want to ask the question, what does this passage say? Because again, they've been raised, and this is probably more your upper level high school students, they know that a literature can be interpreted in many different ways. And they're not even talking, this is not even through their study of the Bible. This is their study about everything, every story, every lesson that they've done in school. And so we want to be careful about saying, this passage proves. We want to be more about, what does this passage say? What does this passage teach? And the fourth thing, because again, it's not because, I'm not saying you shouldn't believe this passage teaches that. I'm saying because it's your tone. It's how you're coming off to your audience. And you want to be careful that we don't turn them away just because we're coming across condescending. And that's what happens when we speak with those words. The last one is fear, please, faithfulness. And this is what I mean by that. In a postmodern society, conversations about faith are welcomed. They're welcomed. Today's universities can be a great place. This is why you hear the phrase, how spirituality is on an all-time high. It's because they love to talk and converse about spiritual ideas on campuses and off campuses and young adults. They want to converse about it. But what they don't want is the whole converting. They don't want you to push converting. And can we be honest? Is converting our job as Christians? It's not. It's not. And that's why fear can flee. Because it's not our job to convert. It's our job to be the, and I'm going to get to this, the aroma of Christ. It is God has always been the one that changes hearts and lives. And we are nothing but instruments of his use. And so we are called to be faithful to the call of God in our lives, to be a tool of his instrument. And that's the verse that talks about that, Romans 6:13. As a tool, our performance is in the hand of the user. The outcome and the results as a tool are in the hands of God. God determines all of that. We are called to be faithful. And one of the neat things about this group tonight is that you are being faithful. You've stepped up. We're to a new year. We're about to start in Sunday school. You have stepped forward and said, God, I want to be faithful with the Sunday school class this year. I want to learn more. I want you to use me. And that's the best place to be, is where you're stepping forward and say, God, use me. where you want to this next year. 2 Corinthians 2:15 says this, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ and manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him in every place. So as you're faithful, God is breathing through you and pushing out through you a sweet aroma of himself. And that is amazingly powerful. And whether they're modern or post-Christian or whatever, they're going to smell it. And they're going to be drawn to it in a powerful way. I was a pastor for my entire life. I was a pastor in college. I got out of college. I went into pastor work. And then I was done. Pastor's hard work, man. Isn't it? It's brutal. I was done. And so I got a job, my day job, working in a school. And it was my first time to ever work in an environment that was not all Christians. And it was just shockingly, all pastors, by the way, should do this. I mean, they just should. It was just so surprising for me, everything about it. And so I tried, honestly, to keep the whole concept of me being an ex-pastor, like, quiet on the down low, so nobody would really know. All I wanted to do is I wanted to go, I wanted to love, and I just wanted to be friends and kind to my coworkers, most of whom were not Christians. Two of my best friends on staff, actually, all year, were clearly not believers and had never been raised in a church. Most of them, they were late, old millennials. So about 30, both of them were. No Christian background at all. Started coming to me. David, this is happening. I don't know what to do. This and this and this and that. And I would just listen to them. I would just talk to them a little bit. And the year went on. About 3 weeks before the end of, before we broke for summer, the three of us were actually right there having a conversation, and the one who'd never been raised in a church turned to me and she goes, guess what I did on Sunday? I'm like, I don't know. What did you do? I became a Lutheran. And literally, probably my face was super shocked. I was completely shocked by this, because she had never talked about faith, she had never talked about religion at all. And yet, I know very clearly why. It was because of our relationship. And I'm not saying that proudly in any means, because I am super broken, and I am not a good evangelist in any ways. But it was so powerful, because my third friend, Amber, turned to me and she goes, I was at church on Sunday too. Sorry, non-emotional side of me, my son wanted to say, stop it! You are not a non-Christian, friends! You are not supposed to go to church! You know, it was just so weird. But yet, God had used the aroma of my life to draw him to himself. And it's just been powerful to see my friends. She'll come in and she goes, yep, my little Jackson, he's now a Jesus follower, and he brings his Bible, and he's this, and all this stuff. And it's just such an amazing change. Nothing that I could orchestrate, nothing that I had to sit down and prove with any of them. And I believe this is what our world is looking for, is lives that are different, who can give a reason for the hope that's in them. Why do you cling to your faith so strongly? Why is that? And that can be beautiful to our world. All right? Let me just say a prayer and then we'll go to Q&A. I still gave you 5 minutes. I stole 20.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but let me just pray. Because you have done the first step, which is just step into a step of role to be faithful. And we'll just pray and see what God does this year. Lord Jesus, I pray that among these people this year, that among this church, that it would smell sweet. That they would be instruments of your righteousness to every boy, every girl, every man, every woman that steps foot in this church, and even outside. In the hallways of this little high school I heard about, that you would just emit an odor that doesn't turn them off, but just draws them into you and into your love and into the hope that you provide the good news, because it is good news for them, God. And so God, be glorified, we pray in our midst, and use us, because we love these people, we love our neighbors. We want them to have the hope that you offer. In Jesus' name. Amen. So.
Fire away.
Yeah, so what kind of transition? None. All right, here we go. So Q&A, I guess, anything on the table? Anything I said in the past? I don't know. So hopefully you both have some questions and comments. It was a lot, and so I do apologize for that. And I'd love to have feedback, so yell at Mark and tell him what you want, or find me online. I don't have here's some resources, by the way. People always want resources and stuff. Some great books on our generation and how it's changing. The best resource, if you want to hear more of my voice, would be on EA Resources. I have a blog. And you can sign up for it, you can get updates. And sometimes I'm just passing it along, especially if you have emerging adults in your home. I really want to encourage you to check out some of the things that I have there about how to parent millennials and what's going on. Obviously, I'm not speaking from experience of parenting, all right? People ask, well, how old are your kids? I can't wait till your kids get older. No, my kids are young, all right? So what I'm speaking from is just what I've seen developmentally in their lives, and as I've worked with them in churches and worked alongside parents for many, many years, okay? So anyway, let me go back to the resources. So questions? Yeah, did you have one? All right.
Yeah, this has been really helpful. I guess I'm probably that baby boomer, or what is the silent generation? I don't know how they delineate.
Yeah.
You know, being a parent and teaching Sunday school and having grandkids, we are coming at things from a different perspective, it's true. And we can't expect people to be thinking the way we think. But how do we hold on to our truth, mm-hmm. and not let it become watered down and still be loving and accepting? You know,
right.
There's some topics that we talked about, some rather hard topics last year, and it was hard to teach it. I think I had some of the easier topics, but
In youth group, you're saying?
In our senior high Sunday school.
In your senior high school, yep.
Carrie and I, her husband Steve, teach senior high and have for a long time. And it's, we want to be loving and kind, but we also want to hold to what is true.
Right, absolutely. There's a lot I could say on that topic. Let me hit on one thing really quick as you were speaking. And that is, I've been ruminating and asking this question a lot. I really believe there's a need for mediators in the church. Those who understand, and that's what I feel I'm being right now. So if you hate me, that's fine. I'm trying to mediate the generations, because it makes me sad to know what's going on within the church. And honestly, I think that's why we have the millennials exiting the church. Partly because those who've stuck with the church, I've heard them cry out. They said, we just want the older generation to trust us, that we love God, and we are going to be faithful with this church. Isn't that powerful to hear that? When I hear those millennials say that, oh my goodness. And they sit in our churches, and what do they hear in sermons? Or what do they hear? The vibe they get is our generation is taking the church to pot. We are going to be the destruction of the church. And so how do we twist that? How do we empower millennials? How do we entrust them in a powerful way that says, we believe in you and your faith and where you're taking the church? That's a big jump. And yet the other side, we have a generation who's going, we have worked so hard. And that's why the need for mediators is so important, because we've worked so hard, we've seen with the church, and we are concerned. And how do we trust you? And so there's a lot of work that has to happen for that to happen, where both sides do trust each other. Watering down, okay? Again, the whole belonging thing, again, as we teach, when you get in trouble, I don't think is what you teach as true. You say, this is what we believe, this is what even I believe. When we, I think, get in trouble in today's world is when we push and say, you must do. we have got to step back and allow the Spirit to work and to let them bring it to conviction on the life of the individual. I think if we sometimes step back, I think that us wanting to see them instantly bring it to fruition in their life and become that Holy Spirit becomes really turn-off-ish. And that's why when sometimes I think the church gets a bad rap. It's not because we necessarily ascribe to certain beliefs and that type of thing, because remember, within communities are free to share their own truth within the community, but within post-modernity. But it's when our tribe goes to your tribe and says, you must be cookie cutter like us, that's when you get into trouble. And so I think you can strongly teach, this is what we believe, this is what we hold to as a community. But we must be careful on forcing it upon others. Is that distinction? I think as we teach that distinction, it's important. And they'll see that. I don't know. And I'm not good at Q&A, so I hope I will do my best. All right? So, other questions? Yeah.
I grew up in a church where at some point you came to realization that you were a sinner and you needed Christ. And there was some kind of, be it baptism or some kind of outward expression of your faith experience.
Yeah.
And one of my concerns is as we take kids through, and maybe postmodern kids through,
I love where you're going with this.
Okay, one of the concerns I have is as they're coming along and they get to be seniors and they're graduating and they're going out in the world, I haven't heard the faith story yet.
Yeah.
And one of my concerns is, do they know it? Do they, they belong and there's, you kind of sense, but there's not that. And part of our system, my system growing up was part of that recognizing their Christianity was that expression of it.
Uh-huh.
And so a little concern of what do they really know when they leave?
Yeah.
Have they really had a faith experience? Have they really come to Christ?
I love that question, okay? Partly because what you're, within modernity, okay, again, probably older Christendom, we wrote in our Bibles, maybe this is just Baptist, okay? So if this is just Baptist, I'm sorry. But we wrote time and date and seconds in our Bibles. If we didn't have a Bible, we were given a Bible and this was written down. Okay? I have like 6 Bibles all with different dates in them. Alright? That I got through childhood. Every VBS I went to, I was handed a Bible and I was in a lot of VBSs. And so, what happened there? Okay, do you see how that is kind of modernism and us trying to lock in and control and make a science? And it's, okay, and it comes from a good root. What you're talking about, us desiring so much that they know and they feel like they have stepped. And does there come a point where you step from belief, unbelief to belief? I believe there is. And so it's normal for us to desire to document it in a way. But you will hear me shying away from some of that. However, that doesn't mean the aspect, I love what you're getting at, is they still have to have a story. And they need to be able to communicate that story. And that's when you talk with, there's a great researcher. If you really like the research, read Christian Smith. University of Notre Dame, what they did is he followed high schoolers through this, and he did studies on what they believed and when, all the way through emerging adulthood, up through college, and then post-college. And he's written a whole series of books, and he's followed these same people through. And he said there was a glaring error among today's Christian young adults. They could not communicate what they believed. They didn't know. A lot of them would ascribe to a belief, but when it came to using terms and phraseology or any kind of language, they had never experienced doing that. And so what you're talking about, hearing their story, is so majorly important. So we have got to force them to. Not in the sense that you have to do this, but are we providing them time to share testimonies, to share truth, to speak, or do we just speak up for them? Are we allowing them to teach, to become passers on? The sooner, let's get them teaching. How many times do they sit and just soak? Let's get them speaking. Let's get them teaching. I don't remember your name.
Luke,
all right? What a great place for Luke to be, but then teaching younger students. Because then he is forced, not just to study, which is great, but he's forced to communicate a faith to others. And that is amazingly powerful. And so those are some of the things that he talks about we have got to do better as a church, is teach them to be able to iterate and to speak their own faith and give them terminology and language for that. So the whole question of when that happens and that point of decision, I'm not sure. In each faith tradition, it's very different. Do you guys honor confirmation here as well?
Yes.
Okay. You know, and I don't want to step on your toes theologically about what that is, and you know, is that the point, is that what, you know, for your tradition, you could probably speak better to that, you know, than I could. But, yes, there is a point, I believe, that where do you step from? I believe. And we need to teach them to speak and to be able to explain and talk about it.
I think that's one of the neat aspects of this denomination, is that they have they don't automatically become a member of the church. They need to tell their faith for it to become a member of the church.
Yeah. Anytime we can get them to share their story, let's celebrate them. And let's not stick them in the youth room when they do it, please. Mm-hmm. Because you know what? If you read my website, I'm a big proponent of intergenerational. Please be a youth worker. Bring your generation down. Let's send them up. Let's bring them together. Because, you know what? If those who are older work besides those who are younger week after week in the nursery or in the 2 and 3 year olds, that will build confidence. That will build health for the church. And that will, it just is beautiful. It can be really beautiful. So, yeah. If you want to read a great book on that, that's what Sticky Faith is about. Yeah, absolutely. So Sticky Faith is a resource, and they did some great research into that area. What causes the faith of emerging adults to stick beyond high school? And one of the unique things is they looked, like they say in the book, we looked for our silver bullet, we found none. You know, there wasn't one clear thing. You know, there's some indicators. One was intergenerational worship, you know, where they're all worshiping as a group and staking together. Intergenerational relationships. It wasn't a cool youth ministry. It wasn't a cool youth pastor. No offense. I'm sure you are super cool. All right. But it's none of those things that they thought it would be. And these were Christian kids who'd gone to youth group. And so they did the research on that group. And so that's why the research from Fuller is fascinating. And so that's why I'm a proponent of changing within the church, pushing towards intergenerational. My thesis, as I did my doctoral work on, because what we're seeing among emerging adults is delayed development. And I do conferences on this, so if you have a large emerging adult populace or parents of emerging, I know I met you, have emerging adults, you know, I do a lot of speaking on. That's my heart, my real desire, is what's causing them to be delayed? Why is it taking longer and longer for them to grow up? You know, Time Magazine gets an article out about how the millennials are narcissistic and lazy and all this garbage, which is super unhealthy, by the way. Super unhealthy for us as a nation to call them lazy and narcissistic. Super unhealthy for the church, because the church does close to the same thing and often mocks them for their use of technology and other things, okay? So it's super unhealthy what's going on. But what I think, as the delayed of development is true, and it is happening, and it's very clear. And so one of the things I promote, besides mentors and intergenerational, is we have to define adulthood for them. And that's what I really focused in on my conferences, is what does it mean to be an adult? And lay that out before them, because we've lost it in today's world. It used to be that adulthood was marked by getting a job, getting married, and having a kid, which most of the people did at 21, 22. But since a lot of those factors have been delayed, like marriage, like having children, like, you know, establishing a job, now they're not an adult now. If you ask a lot of them, they don't feel like they're an adult. So we've got to define adulthood. And so I do that all on my website, but for me, in 30 seconds, there's three biblical aspects of adulthood. Vocation, you've got to teach them to work. And that doesn't mean God called you to a unique this or that or nothing. But no, can they work? Can whatever God lays before you, can you put your hands to it? Do you think God really crafted me to be hit by Eric and yelled at and that type? No. But you know what it does? It's a work for me. And it enables me to love God. It enables me to love my family. And to produce in life. And so, vocation. Can you work? The second thing is autonomy. Do we allow them autonomy and train them to be autonomous? Autonomous means I make decisions and I deal with consequences. By the way, important definitions. I make decisions and I deal with consequences. As parents, parents can be really bad at this. I know, I'm a parent. We protect. Christian families are notoriously bad for this. We protect. Youth groups are notoriously bad at this. We protect. We do not allow them to make questionable decisions. We yell at them for that. Instead, I believe what we should do is we have to train them to be autonomous and allow them to make decisions and fail. I remember I had a parent come to me one time and was like, oh, there was swearing at youth group. And my kid came home and yelled, you know, talking about it. And I'm like, what better place for your kids to experience stuff like swearing and drinking and drugs and all that than in my youth group? Because you know what? There, they have people they can talk about it with. There, they have people that they can dialogue with. And when they come home, as a parent, what do you get to do? You get to parent them. You get to talk to them about it. Because otherwise, guess what? Are they going to experience that stuff? Yes. We're going to send them off to college when they're 18, they're not used to being autonomous, and bam, they experience it. Separated from most institutions in their society. Anyway, I could go on. It's just shockingly. So autonomy, and I call it the evac plan for parents. You know, get them evacuated. Vocation, autonomy, and community. We've got to teach them to build a community. Many of our young adults today believe that being an adult has to do with being independent. Independence is equal to adulthood. It's not. And let me ask you, is that biblical? No. We are called to be interdependent. That is God's design for us from the very beginning, is that we love each other, we mix together, and yet young adults are like, I don't need mom, I don't need dad, I gotta be independent. It's very anti-biblical. And so as an adult, they have to be able to build a community. Can they network around them and include mom and dad? But are they able to build a safety net around them to help them as they move forward? Unfortunately, a lot of kids, especially our kids who are of faith, tend to stay in the very same church their entire lives. And so throughout their 12 years of time, which I'm not complaining against, okay, but what it does to them is if you've been in the same school your whole life, and if you've been at the same church your whole life, you lose the social skills to develop new networks. And so now again, we send them off to college, they've lost a lot of those abilities. And so what they do is they cling to whoever is right beside them. Okay? And because they don't have that autonomy piece, oh man, it gets really ugly. But this is what they do. And so how do you instill in your child the ability to social skills along the way that they are still able to develop that? So anyway, you can find a lot of this on my website. Have you back sometime. I can just talk to emerging adult parents because I love them, and I love emerging adults. I think you are awesome, all right? I see some of you out here. I want to talk to you. I seriously do. I want you to write for me so you can go to my website. I want to hear your voice. So if you're a writer and you're a millennial, let me know. Or if you know a millennial who's a writer, because I want their voice to be heard for the church. And I'm a proponent of it. So anyway.
Oh, I just want to know, do you ever speak to, do you speak to the emerging adults? Do you ever speak to them?
Absolutely, yeah,
and
absolutely.
So that they can kind of understand that you, they understand themselves.
Oh, yeah.
That's
it was neat.
Thing.
I had a conference, it was one of the best things I did. I was in Fargo, North Dakota, and I was talking about, it was a seminar called the Directions to Adulthood. I had an emerging adult in the back, and she goes, I was so pissed as I saw this, this thing. She was like, can I say this?
Yeah.
She was just so angry. She's like, I was mad as soon as I saw the title. I was like, it's going to be another generation bashing. They're going to talk about how we're immature. They're going to talk about this. And she goes, within 10 minutes, she goes, I felt like you got us. You understood us. And she goes, that is so hard to find. And so that was one of my best compliments I've ever received. And that may not be true. The millennials out here might be going, man, you are in left field. I don't know. Because, again, part of the thing is you can't stereotype them either. You can't stereotype any generation. But you can't stereotype millennials. But overall, as you look at development factors, I really want to become a voice for them. And so I think they understand and get that. But, yeah, I do speak to them. I want to. Again, this is not my day job. I have a day job. I'm booked a lot of this year, but definitely, you just send me an email or something. There's information in your tables. So thanks so much. You have other meetings I know you want to get to plan for this year. I will stick around for a few minutes, but I want to honor everyone's time. And I'm reachable. I'm reachable by email and stuff.
Do you want to say thank you?